Well, I'm Paul Levinson. Most of you know that. Thanks for coming. Let me start by saying this is a science fiction convention, as all of you also know. And you might wonder, what is the relationship, at least in my life, between science fiction and the music that you're going to hear, or at least hear some of? And actually, for me, the two have always been right very close together. I remember listening to Buddy Holly on the radio, singing Baby Baby, as I was reading Isaac Asimov's The End of Eternity. That was in the late 1950s. And I'm the kind of person that when I really love something, I want to do it as well as enjoy it as consume it. So I guess it's a good thing that I didn't love nuclear physics, otherwise the world would be totally thrown up right now. And interestingly, I started doing music a long time earlier and before I started writing science fiction. So in the 1960s, I started that decade singing under street lamps on the corner of White Plains Road and Allington Avenue. In fact, I wrote a story called The Harmony about what happened there one night. So you can read that story to find out about it. And as the 60s progressed, I met two guys at a place called Crumbs, where I worked. It was an ice cream parlor. And we formed a group called the New Outlook. And eventually, via that group, we came to meet and know Peter, who I'll say more about in a few minutes. But anyway, by the end of the 1960s, that group was pretty much gone. And I had met someone else, Ed Fox, who was a songwriter and a piano player. I'm going to say a lot more about him later on, too. But for now, I'll say that we wrote a whole bunch of songs together. And we recorded those and a couple of other songs on an album called Twice Upon a Rhyme, which I always thought was a pretty good title. I'm not quite clear what it means. You know, once upon a time, twice upon a rhyme. And we brought it around to a lot of record companies who were interested in it, but I was even more impatient then than I am now, and that's pretty impatient. So eventually, Ed and I said, you know what, let's put it out on our own record label. So we created a label called Happy Sad Records. By the way, we brought Peter to play guitar on all the cuts on the album, and he also co-wrote a song with me on the album. I'll talk more about that as well. But the most that happened with that album, we were reviewed in a couple of places, it was played on a couple of Arcane FM stations, and it promptly faded into almost complete obscurity. I say almost, because it was known, at least in one place, in my home. And over the years, my family suffered through many listenings to the recording, although they claimed they liked it. Well, finally, in 2002, so now pretty much to the end of the story, a magazine in Japan put together an issue called Lost Psychedelic Cult Classics. And they certainly will write about the lost part. They will write about the psychedelic part. I like to think it is a classic. I don't know if anybody else thinks that. But they gave a rave review to Twice Upon a Rhyme. And what this did is it rekindled an interest in the album. And so ever since then, people have been saying, why don't you perform, you know, sing some of these songs somewhere? And then we had a couple of close calls. I actually did sing a song I'm going to sing to you in a minute. At our son's wedding. So it's not that I never performed, but certainly never in an arena such as this. So finally, when the LI concert people said, hey, why don't you do a concert? They didn't have to ask me twice. I said, sure. And that's how we come to be here tonight. So most of the songs on Twice Upon a Rhyme, as I said, were written by Ed Fox and me, but I'm going to start with a song that I wrote totally myself, words and music. and it was about my wife, Tina, who wasn't my wife then. I guess she liked the song, but she became my wife, so at least one person liked it. And I sang that song at our wedding, and as I mentioned, at our son Simon's wedding was over there. And I'm going to sing the song for you now. The song for your eyes. People often say, you know, how do you write songs? How do the ideas come to you?
Do you want me to help you with that?
Because
it's mainly because you're right in front of the speaker.
Yeah.
If you move to the middle and move the speaker,
you do that. No. This is a speaker out, turn it down.
So this is going to be in the video. Okay, this is live.
It's real life.
People always ask me, how do I write songs? For that matter, how do I write stories? And the truth is, there is, at least for me, no one single answer. I get ideas, I write a whole story, a whole song, and I don't even know the title or the ending until the very end. Sometimes that can take years, sometimes it takes minutes. And This next song, however, was written in a somewhat unconventional way. I mentioned Ed Fox. I remember it was a rainy, cold evening in November 1968, and I went up to Ed Fox's house. He lived off York Avenue on East 85th Street. And he was sitting at the piano playing some tune that I don't remember, but he had a newspaper in his hand, and he said to me and pointed the headline, this might be a good title for a song, don't you think? And he pointed to a headline that said, "The LAMA will be late this year." I said, "Yes, that's a great, you know, title for a song." And so I basically wrote the lyrics about 5-10 minutes, and Ed wrote the music. And that song has probably been our most critically acclaimed song, at least on the Vice Partner Rhyme album. In a recent book called The Joy of the Experience, the author said that the LAMA mops the floor as far as garage psychedelic rock is concerned. So I'm going to mop the floor right now. We're going to do the LAMA.
Okay, there's carpet on the floor.
Thank you.
We're fading it out.
You know, what are your musical influences? And of course, growing up right here, it was not only Buddy Holly and the great people from the 50s, but even more so the Beatles and Dylan and the Stones in the 1960s. So there was also another group that I really loved, and I think they don't receive enough credit. One of my all-time favorite songs of all time is Darling Be Home Soon by the Lovin' Spoonful, which came pretty much at the end of their career. I think it never got enough praise. But their earlier songs were spectacular too. You Didn't Have to Be So Nice, You Believe in Magic, the song that John Sebastian wrote for the Critters, Jungle Girl. And so it was with that in mind that I wrote this next song,
which we will play in just a moment.
As soon as Bob makes his way to the phone. Maybe more on key. the song, and by the way, Pete actually has a song on the album that I mentioned, for a song called The Pete Shop, which we were thinking of singing here, but that's the kind of guys we are, we just decided not to. And so it's dead. Here we go with Time Is Money.
Time is money. Here we go. Someone you don't know making a movie out of a story that you wrote. So it's a really excellent feeling. And so this song is called Looking for Sunsets in the Early Morning. And it was always really my favorite lyric. I just, came up with the idea. I, gave Ed a couple of lines. He wrote this beautiful melody. And we wrote that whole song about maybe also 15, 20 minutes. And in many ways, it was the featured song. But again, in the 21st century, after years of nothing much happening, a singer by the name of James Harris in Birmingham, England, recorded the song. And it was a pretty good recording. He sounds like a young Paul McCartney, which can't get much better than that. And then a little after that, a strange rap reggae record, very compelling, by a woman whose name is Jean Boyce, and She was produced by her then husband, Larry Q, recorded Love of the Sunsets. A few years later, Catherine Asaro, who some of you may know who she is, or certainly recognize her name, she's the author of the Scholarly Empire series, Like Me, she had the insanity to be president of the Science Fiction Writers of America, and she's still pretty coherent at that. As for me, you know, I can't be the judge of that. And most recently, a really nice thing has happened. Donnie Franco, as I mentioned, played organ on Vice Upon Rhyme. And again, the album had like so many different people contributing to it, in addition to Ed and me. For example, our saxophone and clarinet player was someone by the name of Boris Midley, who was Russian. And he and I have been pretty good friends. I have no idea whether this is true or not, but the story on him was that he had to leave the Soviet Union because he slept with Nikita Khrushchev's secretary. That's a pretty cool reason. Actually, I hope now that I'm saying this publicly, there's no way that I want like Khrushchev's granddaughter to make him have divorce. I mean, he's in Florida now, he does like some kind of heavy funk metal.
Techno.
Another person on Twice Upon a Rhyme was Linda Kaplan, who was like just like a 17-18-year-old girl, and we wrote some songs together, including something called Not Yet Ready to Say Goodbye. We had a guy by the name of Tony DeSanto do a demo of it. Nothing much happened with that, the story of our lives. But Linda went on to write the Toys R Us commercial. And she's become a best-selling author. She has a new book coming out in a month. I think the title is Grit is Great. And if I got it wrong, she'll kill me. I'm not trying to remember the title, but I think that's pretty much what the title is. Anyway, Donnie Franco played organ and made a good contribution to the album. And about 2-3 years ago, he put together a group called Sundial Symphony. It's just a two-person group, but they go into the studio and they overdub voices. And they did a version of Looking for Sunsets. That was the first song. They also did Today's Just Like You, and they did some videos out of them. The other person in the group is Ronnie Rist, who, if that name sounds familiar to you, I can't remember whether it's the Brady Bunch or the Party at Tree.
Brady Bunch.
Yes. I like the Partridge Family better than I think I love you. But anyway, yeah. The Brady Bunch. And then he went on to be one of the voices of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. That is relevant stuff.
And he was in Galactic 98.
Right, and he was the bus driver in Sharknado 1, and he co-wrote,
what a career.
He co-wrote the theme song of Sharknado 3. So what does this have to do with Looking for Sunsets? I don't know. After that, no, it's because all these people recorded. But here is now the original, Looking for Sunsets in the early morning.
Oh my God.
Go shopping, no. We'll search till the sun dials stop and my heart begins to pour. Looking for sunsets in the early morning. Always longing for more. Baby, baby, looking for sunsets when the world is dawning and love is hiding. Looking for sunsets in the early morning. Looking for sunsets in the early morning, baby. Looking for sunsets in the
No, it's got mic line one overrides all the other ones. It's a talking feature.
This is science fiction.
Alright, and now, as a special treat, another Peter Rosenthal's composition. Now, Peter thinks it's a post-apocalyptic song. To me, it's like a more modern, wasting away Margaritaville. But then I thought, actually, maybe the two things are the same.
Actually, I wrote it about, you know, a calamitous near future. It's called 2020, and here it is.
Where the moon
This song is so new. Actually, unlike all the other songs from Five Spot Around, which were written back in the late 60s, early 70s, I wrote most of this song in 2005. I performed it during an interview on a radio station in Boston. And there's like an insane recording of me singing even less on key than I am here, playing the disc jockey's little daughter's, you know, like these little tiny like musical instruments that look like a little keyboard. I was like playing with my pinky, it was so small. So that's the only recording that exists of it. And from time to time, I write some new lyrics to it. In fact, as we were rehearsing this, I just wrote a couple of lyrics. So that's why I have this sheet in front of me. I want to make sure I get in every one of those lyrics. It's a song, though, that I don't think I'm confident completely enough to write about, because it's a song about fame. That's a dark kind of thing. So I'm talking to O'Reilly Factor three times. I did get the last word on it once. This is called Lime Streets. Consists of 13 tracks. And what studio is that?
Yeah. No, I meant how many multi-tracks.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, no less than 16, and in one or two cases we managed to eke out 32. It was pretty revolutionary, like in 1971. And as far as the studios, that's like a whole novel length story in itself. Because the thing to bear in mind is, like, Ed and I were both incredible cheapskates, and we didn't want to have to pay the studio time. It was pretty expensive. I haven't changed a bit, I could say. But so what we do is go around to various studios and proposition them along the lines of, hey, if you let us record this, we'll give you a cut of sad to say, not a single one of those places that sold pen, because I told you, the album sold a negative number of copies. But among the studios was A1 Recording Studios, run by Herb Abramson of Atlantic Records fame. Had produced a whole bunch of things there, even things that were not on the album, some bubblegum songs.
Memory Goes Round?
Yes, Memory Goes Round, and also Ring Around My Rosie, written by a guy named David Fox, no relation to Ed. And that became like a hit in Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania. That's how we met Tony DeSanto, a long story there. A place called Audio Recording Studio in Cedar Grove, New Jersey. And then there was a recording studio, and I can't remember the name of it, it's on the album, somewhere like in the depths of Brooklyn. It took like 2 hours to get out there, but again, didn't cost us anything. We went out there like 2 a.m, worked until 6 a.m, and that's where we pretty much finished off the album and did the final mixes. But all the recording studios are listed on the album, and it's probably about 7 or 8. I think we even wanted Associated Studios. They were a pretty big studio. We met people called Mary at one point. I sang a song for them. It wasn't leaving on a jet plane. That's how they know.
Well, it's funny, when you and Ed, when you left, I came in and he taught me the meaning of spec deals. Because we did the same thing.
My specialty, yes.
With Media Sound, and our kid engineer was Bob Clearmount.
Amazing.
When he was like 17.
Yeah. There was a studio, I don't remember the name, it was on 57th Street off Broadway. And several things about that studio, we recorded a couple of tracks in that studio. One is that Stevie Wonder was recording, There's a Thing in the Sun, da da da. Everyone was a huge hit record. And Stevie Wonder hated that song. He didn't write the song. It was sort of forced upon him by Barry Gordy. So that's always struck me as interesting. And the other is, in that studio, we had a violin player whose name, we had two violin players. One of them was Israel Eskenazi, some kid who played violin. And the other, I don't remember his name, it's on the album, was another guy. He was a friend of Boris Mindy, another escapee.
Sasha.
Sasha. Sasha, that's right. And you can hear on the album at the beginning, this is like the story of our lives, he's basically confused. It's just like, I'm still letting you on there, which basically translates into I'm confused, I don't know where to start. So you can see, nothing much has changed.
The music was in English.
That's right. So we had a good, and that was a good recording session as well. So yeah, we rang up a good streak of free recording sessions. I'm heartened to hear that I carry on the tradition with you. It's the only way to go. Otherwise, it costs you a fortune.
It's too bad they didn't have what they had today back then.
That's right.
I thought Super K was paying her.
What was Super K?
Cassidy and Cats.
No, that was later.
Okay. Yeah. All right. I was confused.
Yeah, no. What we did, what was going on with her was we had a connection with Buddha Records.
Right.
That's where we were in my
Right, right.
And that was part of the falling out that we had. Buddha Records wanted us to do something or didn't agree with it. And his wife got angry at us. Crazy thing. That whole thing, A1 Sound Studios, was located in this old hotel, which itself is like out of some kind of gothic novel. And as I was saying, before we began singing, one day Ed and I were walking into the studio, and there was this, I can only describe her as like a strange, luminous woman. I mean, she did have some kind of glow to her. And we got into a conversation, and it emerged from the conversation, she claimed, she said her name was Suzanne. And she said she was the Suzanne that Leonard Cohen based his song, Suzanne Takes You Down. So I have no idea whether it's true or not. But I mean, whenever I tell people that story, they say, so she obviously was making that up, but there was something that was very believable. What time is it?
9:45.
So a few more minutes.
Do you remember walking into A1 one day and Johnny Nash was there,
yes,
listening to a recording track?
Yes.
Before he did,
He did a rock steady thing?
No, before he did, I can see clearly.
Yeah, I can see clearly now.
So that's not my imagination, right?
No, that's not your imagination. Johnny Nash recorded that.
Okay.
And Lloyd Price recorded that once. I get him once in Lloyd Price's singing. This was long after he did his hit record, sadly. The night was clear, the moon was yellow. But yeah, he was singing. It's a great song. And yeah, there were all kinds of characters. There were good relatives. Yes.
Did you say Herb Peterson?
Herb Abramson.
Abramson.
Yeah. No, you can look him up. He's a real thing. He was basically, you know, a white guy who, along with the Arrogants, who I don't know if they're still alive, maybe they are, they're Turkish, they founded Atlantic Records. But Herb was really the leading influence in basically breaking out African American groups. And he was really into it. He really had a great idea. He also introduced Ted and me to soul food. You know, we lived in New York City, we never had it before, but it took us to a restaurant one night. It was fabulous. One of the best meals I ever had. He was a great guy. He really.
He was a hep cat. Yeah. Really. He was, you know, one of those hep cat guys.
That's right. Yeah, I don't know what to make this, but you know, maybe this was really, he wore like the worst pants. He like wore pants that like hung off him. It's like, I don't know what it's like. I can't even really explain.
And the Hawaiian shirts.
That's right. Well, the Hawaiian shirts, in the recording of The Love Will Be Late, you just heard this song itself. But before the song, Ariane does a whole preamble, which I pleaded with Peter to do. He didn't want to do it. It's about 3 or 4 minutes of nonsense. And in that, you know, gibberish, you hear me talking about Herb's Hawaiian shirt.
Yeah.
Because he wore horrible pants and like Hawaiian shirts. I'm sorry. And, listen, thank you very much. We're really